محمدا رسول الله. حي على الصلاة.
ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهد الله تعالى فلا مضل له، ومن يضل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت وهو حي لا يموت، بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح للأمة وكشف الغمة وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء، ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك، فعليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم، وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. آمين رب العالمين. وأوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله، وقد أمرنا بالحق، وقال تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. ثم أما بعد، I'm going to ask everyone to move forward from now inshallah, since we already have an issue in the back. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and asking Him to send His peace and blessings upon the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family, his companions, and those that follow until the Day of Judgment. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to overlook our shortcomings and to overlook our sins, those that are committed intentionally and those that are committed unintentionally, and to clean our hearts and make us amongst those that meet Him with a submitting and a peaceful and tranquil heart. And we ask Allah to join us with the Prophet ﷺ in the highest level of Jannat al-Firdaus. Allahumma ameen. Dear brothers and sisters, this concept of a community comes with many different ways. And I know that last week the khutbah was about building a community and establishing a community in many ways. And when we talk about unifying our ranks, we often talk about it from a very practical perspective. We talk about it in a pragmatic fashion, in the sense of unifying our efforts, in the sense of not letting our differences come between us and things of that sort. But at the end of the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made this an issue of the heart. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises this community and how He unified our hearts. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us to hold on to the rope of Allah and not to become divided, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا. Remember the favor of your Lord when you were nothing but warring tribes, warring Bedouins, who had all sorts of difficulties, could not get along, whose parents killed off each other, who would fight over the silliest of things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala united you through that rope of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought your hearts together. فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا. And like that, you became brothers. Just like that, you became brothers. You went from wanting to kill one another to actually becoming brothers who would die for one another. And it was a very beautiful community. And when we talk about the Sahaba and we talk about the companions, obviously, you know, we take them as an example and we have to worry about our own selves. But this idea of actually bringing people together to a point that not only do they wish well for one another, but they pray for one another. They strive for one another. And that's not even limited to their own generation. They care deeply about those that have passed, and they care deeply about those that are to come. They are actively trying to make sure that they uphold the legacy of great people that came before them, that tried to establish righteousness on this earth, and also leave behind a world that is not corrupt, and that is one that our grandkids and our great-grandkids can grow up also worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and thriving both in the worldly sense and in the religious sense. And Allah establishes this throughout the Qur'an. Allah tells us, and it's very powerful because He mentions to us the prophets that came before making dua for us, supplicating for us. And the prophets that He chooses to mention making dua for us, supplicating for us, for the believers, for their brothers and sisters, that would come thousands of years later, in that is a lesson. Allah chooses to mention to us before anyone else, Nuh alayhi salam, the first Rasul, the first messenger of God, praying for the believers. A man who obviously was bitter about the rejection that he faced over 950 years. But at the same time, he still had a love for the believing men and women that would come after him. And so Allah mentions his dua as the first dua in the Qur'an, as the first supplication in the Qur'an for all of the believers to come, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَالَ رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِي وَالِدَيَّ وَلِمَنْ دَخَلَ بَيْتِيَ مُؤْمِنًا. Oh Allah, forgive me and forgive my parents and all that will enter into this house as believers. Everyone that enters into the sanctity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, into those that place of protection, which is iman, which is belief. Then Allah chooses to mention to us Ibrahim alayhi salam, the father of the Abrahamic nations, the father of ad-din al-hanifiyya, monotheism, and those that worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the way that's most beloved to Him. Allah mentions Ibrahim making dua for us in many different ways. He says, رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Oh Allah, forgive me, forgive my parents, and forgive the believers. And the scholars say here that there's a trend. He's making dua for himself, for the parents that pass, and for the believers that are to come, for those that will come after him. Then Allah brings it back to us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ جَاءُوا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ. And those that came after him, those that came after these generations of believers, after generation after generation, striving to uphold the same message of Allah, striving to establish righteousness and justice and mercy on the face of the earth. Allah says, and those that came after them, يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا وَلِإِخْوَانِنَا الَّذِينَ سَبَقُونَا بِالْإِيمَانِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they say, oh Allah, forgive us and forgive our brothers. We reciprocate the dua. Forgive those that came before us, that surpassed us in faith. وَلَا تَجْعَلْ فِي قُلُوبِنَا غِلًّا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And oh Allah, don't place in our hearts any hatred for those who believe. Take any sort of hatred out of our hearts for the brothers and the sisters that are around us, for the believers that are around us. Now, I'm not going to take this in a direction of the effects on a community that it has when people's hearts are united, and how that brings about a more cohesive unit, a more cohesive ummah, that's able to be more productive because they're not distracted by their differences. Because when you're engaged in negativity, it naturally hinders your productivity as an individual and as a nation. But I want to bring this back to our hearts, to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses as the core. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches us, as in accordance with this ayah, that it starts with wishing well for people. You know, it's an actual psychological disorder. I can't think of the name. It's a long German name. People that actually, you know, find happiness and pleasure in the misfortune of others. There are people that are sick in that sense, that they actually take joy in the misfortunes of others. When they see others struggling, it actually makes them happy. And that's something that the Prophet ﷺ warns us about. Both that we be the victim of that and that we are the perpetrators of it. He taught us in his dua, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min ghalabati ad-dayn. Oh Allah, I seek refuge in you
from being overpowered by debt. Debts are not fun in this world. Debt, when you're living in debt, you know, it hinders your spirituality. It hinders many things, many of your pursuits. And so the Prophet ﷺ taught us that it is in fact healthy to live a lifestyle where we don't place ourselves in debt. One of the wisdoms of the abolishment of riba, the institution of interest and usury in his society, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to free us from debt. That's part of our du'as. It's established through multiple du'as of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he said, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min ghalabati ad-dayn wa ghalabati al-adu. And I seek refuge in you, O Allah, from being overcome or by being overpowered by an enemy, by someone who wishes me harm. And he says, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wa shamatati al-a'da. And from the evil of those people that take pleasure in my misfortune. From the people that actually watch from the sidelines. And when they see my life collapsing, when they see terrible things happening to my family, when they see me struggling spiritually, when they see me falling off and engaging in things that I'm not supposed to be engaging in, when they see me going down and when they see me tanking, they actually find joy in their hearts. The Prophet ﷺ taught us to seek refuge from shamatat al-a'da, from those types of people and from them being afforded that pleasure. And the Prophet ﷺ tells us, I mean, look, it will come back around. So he warns those that are like that, those people that are like that, those people that actually do take joy and seeing other people fall and seeing other people fail, that actually do find some sort of happiness out of it. And he says, عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ لَا تُظْهِرِ الشَّمَاتَةَ لِأَخِيكَ. Don't ever allow yourself to have that shamata, to have that feeling of ill will, actually wishing bad for your brother. And listen to what he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, فَيَرْحَمُهُ اللَّهُ وَيَبْتَلِيكَ. He said, Allah might have mercy on him and lift him out of that misfortune and then test you with it. And there's another narration which the Prophet ﷺ, it's a weak narration, but it's something that the companions and the scholars quoted. That whoever humiliates his brother or his sister with a sin, he will not die until he has committed that same sin. SubhanAllah, we ask Allah to protect us. You see this, you see, and it doesn't necessarily have to be your peer. You see a young person in your community struggling, and you mock them, or you don't feel any sense of goodwill for that person, wanting that person to come back and find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Instead, you mock that person, and you taunt that person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't let you die until you are guilty of committing that same sin in some manifestation. Don't be that individual. So before we can even talk about wishing well for people, we have to lift the evil of ghil, the evil of shamata, the evil of wanting bad for people in our hearts, the spite and the hatred that actually would make us find happiness in the misfortunes of others. Instead, we find ourselves being directed by the Prophet ﷺ towards this habit of making dua for people, actually wishing well for people and taking the time out to actually supplicate for them. To supplicate for those that have been kind to you, so to supplicate for those that have not been so kind to you. To supplicate for people that you've met, to supplicate for people that you've never met before. To supplicate for people in your locality, to supplicate for people that are in Syria, that are in Burma, that are wherever they may be. To just to let your dua spread across time and across place. And let it become a habit of yours where you actually force yourself to pray for people. Where you actually force yourself to make dua for people. And Dr. Aad al-Qarni, who we all know, you know, many people might know, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for him, was attacked in the Philippines a week ago and is recovering now. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant him health and safety and protection. He said something very beautiful once. He said that if we made dua for each other as often as the Prophet ﷺ made dua for his enemies, then we'd be okay. SubhanAllah, I mean, we find so many instances of the Prophet ﷺ making dua for his enemies. Allahumma ighfir li qawmi fa innahum la ya'lamun. We spoke about this a couple of weeks ago, where the Messenger ﷺ is being attacked in Uhud and saying, Oh Allah, forgive my people, they just don't know any better. If we were able to bring that same love and that same compassion and that same dua and implement it amongst each other as brothers and sisters, we'd be in a much better situation. And that is the community that the Prophet ﷺ wished to establish. And that's the spiritual bond that the Prophet ﷺ wished to bring amongst us. And he himself initiates this, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu said that I went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and I asked for his permission to perform Umrah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave Umar permission and then he said to me, La tansani ya akhi min du'a'ik. Don't forget me, O my brother, in your prayer. Can you imagine the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam telling you to make du'a for him? Don't forget me in your prayer when you go to Umrah. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, I mean, and this is a beautiful testimony to who he is, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made it a point to ask him for his du'a. Now, if we're being very honest with ourselves, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam really doesn't need the du'a of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. We need his intercession, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We need his du'a. We need his example, alayhi salatu wa sallam. He's set, but he's bringing about a culture of bonding spiritually and actually making du'a for one another. And Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, don't forget me in your du'a, O my brother, he says, كَلِمَةً مَا يَصُرُّنِي أَنَّ لِي بِهَا الدُّنْيَا. He said that this word, I wouldn't have traded that sentence for the entire world. SubhanAllah, the entire world being presented to me was not more beloved to me than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying to me, don't forget me in your du'a. And it became a culture. The narrator of the hadith, Asim radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he met Shu'bah, when he heard the hadith from Asim, he said to him, أَشْرِكْنَا يَا أَخِي فِي دُعَائِكَ. He said, since you're narrating the hadith to us, make du'a for us. It was a culture. Make du'a for us. Make du'a for us. That we actually encourage one another to pray for us. And we keep that type of bond and that type of well-wishing. Now at the end of the day, no one's du'a is going to be more sincere for something that you need most likely than your own. Except for probably the du'a of a parent. Your du'a for some good in your own life is probably going to be more powerful and more sincere than anyone else's du'a for you. But that's a culture. That's something that the Prophet ﷺ wants to bring about amongst us. Not to depend on the du'a of another person, like I'm really messing up. Can you make du'a for me so I can continue to mess up? But you're close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will accept your forgiveness. It doesn't work like that. But at least to bring the hearts together. And the Prophet ﷺ teaches us even more than that. Not just as a means of empty words and, hey, make du'a for me and make du'a for me and so on and so forth. But really more than anything else, to wish well for people while they don't even see us and to make du'a for them without them having any clue of it. بِظَهْرِ الْغَيْبِ. Without anyone even knowing about it. And that's something that's very beautiful and very powerful. Because it's between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Safwan ibn Abdullah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was the son-in-law of the great companion Abu Darda radiallahu anhu. He was married to the daughter of Abu Darda. And Safwan says that I was on my way to Hajj and I went to the house of my in-laws, Abu Darda and Umm Darda. And he said, and I only found my mother-in-law, I found Umm Darda radiallahu anha, also a great companion. And he said that she said to me, تُرِيدُ الْحَجِّ الْعَامِ, are you going to Hajj this year? And I said, yes. And she says, فَدْعُوا لَنَا بِخَيْرٍ. She said, so when you go, make du'a for us. فَإِنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ كَانَ يَقُولُ. Because verily the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to say, دَعْوَةُ الْمَرْءِ مُسْتَجَابَةٌ لِأَخِيهِ بِظَهْرِ الْغَيْبِ. That the du'a of a brother for his brother is answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is مُسْتَجَاب بِظَهْرِ الْغَيْبِ. When it is unseen, when no one knows about it. And she continued. She said that he said, عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ عِنْدَ رَأْسِهِ مَلَكٌ يُؤَمِّنُ عَلَى دُعَائِهِ. On his head, as he makes du'a at his head, there is an angel that is saying Ameen to his du'as. كُلَّمَا دَعَى لِأَخِي. Every single time you make du'a for your brother or sister, that angel says Ameen وَلَكَ بِمِثْرِهِ. Ameen and for you as well. So you get two benefits out of this. The angel is saying du'a for you, is making du'a for you. Because, you know, at the end of the day, your du'a is probably not as good as that angel's du'a. And also your brother is getting that benefit. Your brother and your sister is getting that benefit. And that's something that's very beautiful, because many of the scholars, they taught us that if you want something in your life, then make du'a for your brother or your sister to have it as well. Make du'a for your brother and sister to have it as well. It'll probably be a better chance of you getting in it, getting a part of them. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that, I don't know from which avenue khayr comes in my life, from which avenue good comes in my life. You know, there are different avenues that good comes into your life. But if I engage myself in making dua for people's afiyah, for people's well-being, their health, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send health my way. And if I engage in making dua for my brother and sister to have goodness in their wealth, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends wealth my way. And if I engage in my, you know, in dua for my brother and sister, for something that's good, anything that's good, something of this akhirah, then I hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send me the goodness of this akhirah as well. Meaning if I'm asking Allah, oh Allah, forgive my brother and sister, oh Allah, guide my brother and sister, the angel is also saying, وَلَكَ بِمِثْرِهِ, and for you as well. It's not just tangible things. It's not just, you know, it's not like you walk into a car dealership and you see a car and you say, oh Allah, give my brother this car, right? And you definitely don't do that for someone that you want to marry. Oh Allah, give my brother this woman, right? You pursue that person and you do what you've got to do. But it's a general wish for good, wanting for good. And it should extend far beyond something of this dunya, far beyond this world, to actually wish for guidance for them, to actually wish for maghfirah, forgiveness. Because Allah is teaching us, particularly, to ask forgiveness for people. Oh Allah, forgive that person. Oh Allah, grant that person Jannah. Oh Allah, guide that person. And to engage in that frequently. And you know, subhanAllah, this idea of doing it behind their back makes it far more sincere. It makes it far more sincere because sometimes dua becomes like leverage, right? You know, I can't believe you're doing this to me. I make dua for you every day, right? It becomes a form of leverage in an argument or in a discussion. But Allah is teaching us, the Prophet ﷺ is teaching us to keep this habit when no one is seeing us, when it's just between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is something that we also learn from, that we are to solicit people's dua, not just by words, but actually by being good people. Do good for people so that they'll want to make dua for you. Do good for people so that they want to make dua for you. And Umm Darda radiallahu anha, once again, we come back to this beautiful couple. She said that, I once heard Abu Darda making dua throughout the entire night, the dua of the Prophet ﷺ, Allahumma kama ahsanta khalqi, ahsan khuluqi. Oh Allah, as you have beautified my external appearance, as you have perfected it, perfect my character, perfect my internal appearance. And she said, I asked Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, I was like, you spent the entire night making dua for good character. You didn't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for anything else. And you know what he said? He responded and he said that whenever a brother wakes, whenever a person has good character, and he shows that good character to others, even when he is sleeping at night, his brother or his sister is waking up making dua for him. And so that person, and he actually said that the Muslim is forgiven, the believer is forgiven even as he is sleeping, even as you've gone to sleep. If you're in the service of people, you're someone that helps people, you're someone that's there for people. When you go to sleep at night, those people might stand up and make dua for you. And he said, verily the believer is forgiven while he is sleeping. Even as you're asleep, that person continues to seek forgiveness for you. And so if you have good character, you have it all. If you treat people well, then you have it all. And on the opposite end of that, obviously, is that you don't do anything to solicit a bad supplication from someone. Because as Al-Hafidh ibn Rajab rahimahullah ta'ala says, that if one mazloom, one person that you've wronged makes dua against you, that can nullify the dua of thousands of people for you. If you wrong one person, and that person calls upon Allah against you, and they have a right, they have a haq, this isn't because they felt like they were wrong, but they were indeed wronged. And the Prophet ﷺ tells us that the dua of the mazloom, that the supplication of a wrong person, لَيْسَ بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَ اللَّهِ حِجَابٍ, there is no veil between that person's dua and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's enough to void the dua of thousands and thousands of people for you. Why? Because that person has a right upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you took that person's rights. You took that person's rights. So you live your life in a way, you act in a way, that people would naturally want to make dua for you. You don't even have to ask them for it. You know, Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that when you give charity to someone, you don't ask them, you know, it's a habit sometimes when you give charity to someone, you say, make dua for me. He says, don't ask them for that, because Allah tells us in Surah Al-Insan, لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا, that we should want nothing in return for our charity. And dua is a form of jaza. Dua is a form of payment. So don't even ask for dua. Just be good to people. Just give charity to people. You don't have to make them feel like you're demanding it from them. Make them want to make dua for you. And when you live your life in that way, when you're someone that makes dua for people and wishes well for people, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send people your way that will do the same. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to create that type of community. One of the most beautiful things I've ever seen in my life is that one time in my Hajj group, I've heard of people like this, but this was my first time actually seeing it. That there was a brother in my Hajj group who was making Hajj on behalf of Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala. And I'm sitting there thinking to myself, like, subhanAllah, how many years later, hundreds of years later, and he's still thinking about the goodness that he got from Imam al-Nawawi. When I asked him why, he said, because the first collection of hadith that I studied was Arba'een al-Nawawi, were the 40 hadith of al-Nawawi. And it changed his life. It changed his life. It benefited him. So if you're someone who benefits others, you will naturally have people making dua for you, even if they come hundreds and hundreds of years after, if you've done something good enough, if you've been there for people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will turn those hearts so that they will make dua for you as well, even if you yourself are not soliciting it. And on the opposite end, obviously, do not be a person. لَا تُبْطِلُوا صَدَقَاتِكُمْ بِالْمَنِّ وَالْأَذَى. Don't be a person who voids his charity by man and adha, which means by boasting about it. If you go to your brother and your sister and you tell them that you're making dua as a form of man, as a form of boasting, then it can actually be a form of riya. It can actually be a form of showing off and can actually be against you on the Day of Judgment. It can mean absolutely nothing. If you say it sometimes as a form of hub, as a form of love, to show that, look, I love you, then that's fine. But when you say it with the intention of boasting, then it takes away all of the barakah, all of the goodness of that dua, which is why the Prophet ﷺ specified, بِظَهْرِ الْغَيْبِ. When you're all alone and no one sees you. SubhanAllah, how beautiful. All alone and no one sees you. And you push yourself and you bring yourself to say, oh Allah, guide that person. Oh Allah, forgive that person. Oh Allah, that person is going through hard times, make it easy for them. You actually push yourself to deprive yourself of sleep in the last third of the night. To make dua for people. To ask Allah for their goodness. How beautiful is that? And Imam bin Rajab rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that just as that brother is bidhahri al-ghayb, is unseen, the angel is also unseen. And both of them are making dua. Both of them are making dua. So it's a beautiful equation. It's creating this tranquility and it's creating this correlation. And this companionship between brothers and also between angels and human beings. That the angels are making dua for you because you are making dua for that person without that person even seeing you. And I'll end with a beautiful story. And it's one, subhanAllah, that is very touching. It's not the Prophet ﷺ, but it's very touching and it truly is an example for us. And it shows you how a family is also established and how children are raised with good adab, with good manners. Abdullah ibn Imam Ahmad, Abdullah the son of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he said that I used to see my father every single night when he would wake up for Qiyam al-Layl, when he'd wake up for his last third of the night, he'd pull out a sahifa, he had a little tablet, and he had on it the names of all sorts of people that he would make dua for at night. He actually used to keep a list of people to make dua for at night when no one was watching him. And he said that I've never seen on that list, he used to erase and put names and so on and so forth, I've never seen on that list any less than 70 people. And he said the people on that list included his teachers, it included his scholars, it included his parents, it included his family members, it included his students, it included the people that tortured him in prison. SubhanAllah, when he used to stand up at night, he even had the names of the people that were torturing him, that used to torture him when he was in prison. And he would stand up every night and he would read their names and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for goodness for them. And he says one night, he was really tired and he slept past the usual point of the night where he'd wake up. These people didn't have alarm clocks back then, right? They woke up at a particular time. It was instilled inside of them to wake up at a particular time in the night. So he said he usually used to wake up at this time. And he slept a little past that. And he said, I saw him wake up and he was sweating. So I went up to him and I told him, what happened? Did you see some sort of nightmare? Did you see some sort of shaitan? What happened? Why are you sweating? So he said that while I was sleeping, he said, I saw in a dream all of these deceased brothers and sisters, all of these people that I usually make dua for, his teachers and the people that he used to know that passed away, subhanAllah, across his generations. And he said they were all standing in front of me. And they said, هلا قمت فأسرجت علينا قبورنا. Shouldn't you stand up and light up our graves a little bit? Shouldn't you stand up and ask Allah to forgive us and send something our way? SubhanAllah. These are people that passed away. And this shows you, when he would stand up so sincerely for them. It wasn't just reading off the list, oh Allah, forgive Muhammad, Umar. No. One by one, he takes his time. He reflects on their circumstances. He empathizes with those that are alive and he makes dua for them. One by one with his enemies, he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide and to forgive. One by one, by those who passes away, he mentions the good that they used to do and he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on them and forgive. And so how many dead brothers and sisters that have passed away are wondering the same thing about us? Shouldn't you be up seeking forgiveness for us? Shouldn't you be lighting up our graves with good deeds and forgiveness on our behalf? We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us people whose hearts are filled with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the love of the believers and the love of people. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us a people who are driven to sincerity, to sincerely make dua for their brothers and sisters, those that have wronged them and those that have assisted them, those that have passed and those that are living. Allahumma ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa li sa'iril muslimin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us and to purify our hearts. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to allow our hearts to go astray after they have been guided. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove any form of ghil, any form of hatred or envy or jealousy or pride from our hearts. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to unite our hearts and unite our ranks. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us productive as individuals and as communities, and to be amongst those that strive with the methodology and the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ to bring about greatness in this world and to achieve greatness for themselves and salvation in the hereafter. Allahumma ighfir lil mu'minina wal mu'minat wal muslimina wal muslimat al ahya'i minhum wal amwat innaka sami'un qareebun mujibud da'wat. Allahumma ighfir lana warhamna wa'fu 'anna wa la tu'adzibna. Rabbana zalamna anfusana وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. اللهم إنك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم إنك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم اغفر لوالدينا رب ارحمهما كما ربونا صغارا. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين وجعلنا للمتقين إماما. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والكاذبين ودمر أعداء الدين. اللهم أهلك الظالمين بالظالمين وأخرجنا وإخواننا من بين المسالمين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه على نعمائه يزد لكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة.